coming up next.
He went down with some power. He went down with some miracles being done. He went down doing some things for God. But when he got up with all power. Not some, but all power. He is now the bread of life. He is the resurrection. He is the rose of Sharon. He is the great I am.
Welcome to love.
You have an attitude problem? I have an attitude problem? You're talking about me? Oh. I don't have no attitude problem. Can we remember growing up? And even now, hearing that? Every time something is wrong, every time somebody walk around with a little chip on their shoulder, they got an attitude problem. Don't we say that? Attitude is a big deal. People judge you. They sum you up by your attitude. Your attitude is important. It makes a very big difference in your life. Young people, pay attention. Paul told the Philippian church, your attitude should be like that of Christ Jesus. The scriptures are full of examples of entitled to fail or endowed to succeed. The cross of the matter is it is the attitude of a person that gives birth to one position or the other. And I'm sorry, because last week we talked about entitled to fail, endowed to succeed. And this morning's message is the power of being endowed. So the attitude of a person, it gives birth to either one or the other. Joshua was one of the greatest leaders in scripture and all of history. He led Israel out of the promised land, into the promised land, and divided the land among the tribes. Joshua was the successor to Moses. Joshua 1 says, Moses was the servant of the Lord, but Joshua was Moses' servant. For 40 years, that's a long time. 40 years, Joshua faithfully served Moses. And when God called Moses to come up to the mountain, Joshua could not go all the way, but he went further than anyone else. So it paid off for him serving God. 40 years is a long time. I wonder if God gave you an assignment that was going to take 40 years. Could you hang just that long? Last week, we talked about Samson. Last week, we talked about his strength and how Delilah, tricked him. We want to say tricked, or, you know, he fell into the hands of Delilah, really. But he was in the midst of fulfilling his purpose. But see, with Delilah, he lost sight of his destiny. Now, purpose is an endowment. It's a gift. And destiny is the reward of your gift. You are gifted and with purpose. God has entrusted you with purpose. In other words, he has entrusted you with a gift, which that is your purpose. And you cannot do purpose without sacrifice or giving of yourself. See, purpose cannot manifest if you don't put nothing into purpose. Michael Jordan was an excellent basketball player. Tiger Woods is a magnificent golfer, but they both had to put time in to their gift. They were gifted to do what they do. But if they had not put the time into developing the gift, would the gift have taken them to their destiny? You can't even develop your gift without sacrifice or giving of yourself. Only when a seed dies does it produce life. So in other words, only when I die to self, only when my wants die, only when my needs die, only when what I want to do die, and when that dies, then God's purpose is going to manifest in me. And your reward is your destiny. And your destiny is the fulfillment of your endowment from God. See, entitlement makes us think we deserve something. Just give it to us. No reason, no justification. I just deserve that because of who I am. I don't know. Who are you? That's the first question. Who are you to think that you deserve whatever it is that you think you deserve? What have you done to deserve it? And who are you any different than anyone else? That you deserve something that someone else has gotten? That's why we have the problems that we have today. People robbing each other, or people breaking into your house, or you know, people doing things and taking your stuff because they feel like they deserve that. That's why they do it. They feel entitled to it. They feel like this, you got it, I'm gonna take it. You have enough of it that I can take some, you can give me some and it won't matter. That's not true. What I have, you are not entitled to it. When endowment comes from serving and waiting. See, there's a wait in it. Joshua had to wait 40 years. Not 40 months, not 40 days, not 40 hours, but 40 years. And if we read the Bible, notice that everybody that got something waited years. We want something overnight. Our children don't want to wait 2 minutes. They'll ask you for something and think you're supposed to go get it right now and get it done. But some of us are like that too. See, an endowment comes from serving and waiting. And even then, what we receive, the Lord say, it's a hard thing. Elijah followed and served Elijah for 12 years. When it was time for Elijah to be taken away, he asked him what he wanted because what he wanted before he was taken. Elijah answered and said, a double portion of your spirit. He desired what God had given Elijah. And that's okay. Elijah's response was, you have asked a hard thing. In other words, it's just not that easy. See, whatever your gift is, wherever your destiny is, it's not that easy. See, this is not an easy thing. This is not so easy that you don't even feel any pain or suffering or sacrificing in it. It's not easy. Then after he said it wasn't easy, he even added a condition to it. He said, you must see me when I am taken from you. If not, listen to this, if not, it shall not happen. In other words, you can serve me for 12 years, but if you happen to turn your back, and I happened to leave, you didn't see me. So all that you done, you done messed up because you got tired, because you got, you know, disgusted, because the devil discouraged you. The devil told you, why you doing that? Why you keep serving him? And you know what serving him was? He was washing his hands when he came out the bathroom. That's all. He wasn't doing anything else. Washing his hands when he came out the restroom. So that means I got to pay attention. If you go to the restroom at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, I got to get up to be there to wash your hands. I know you're getting quiet. I know it's quiet. Because you know what? If you miss it, you can't get this. At the end of their time together, in the first 7 verses, Elijah even tried to discourage him and from following him. But see, I don't know. I kind of said he's discouraging him, but I think it was kind of a test. It was a test to see, you really want this? Because see, everything we think we want, because it's on somebody else, it looks good on them. But when it get on you and what it requires of you and what you have to do to keep it, my God, then things might change. So he said, I need to let you go. Why don't you just go ahead and do something else? But Elijah was smart. He knew the importance of staying with him, because he wanted it. He felt like, I can do whatever I need to do with it. Because see, it had to be a willing spirit in him, because when God gives you something, you have to do what God said do with it. What we have does not originate with us. It doesn't come from us. We didn't create it. Nor does it belong to us. See, when we think what we have belongs to us is when we start walking in entitlement. It all belongs to God. It's all of God. That's the endowment. Romans 11:36 tells us, for from him and through him and to him are all things. So that means I don't care what you have. I don't care what kind of idea you have. I don't care what kind of talent you have. I don't care what you can do and how you can do it. Some of them folks that do the acrobats and stuff can twist all kind of different ways. All that's from God. Philippians 1:6, for I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day Christ Jesus. That means he started it, he put it there, he started it, and he'll finish it if you let him. Philippians 2:13, for it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. I love this. 1 Corinthians 4:7. For who regards you as a superior? What do you have that you did not receive? In other words, what do you have that God didn't give you? Name it. What do you own, or what do you have that God didn't give you? See, that's what happens when you take your endowment and start walking in entitlement. You think that what you have and what you have consumed is yours. And you think you got it on your own merits. We think jobs. See, we get this thing twisted up here. You know, we go to work every day. We raise children. We spend our money. We buy a house. We buy a car. you know, we buy furniture, we buy food, we buy clothes. And we think all that stuff belonged to us. We think it came through us. I got a surprise for you. If God didn't give you the strength, not only if he didn't give you the strength, if he didn't give you the knowledge to go on a job and do whatever it is that you have to do. So you cannot separate anything that you have from God. If you can, let me know. We have to understand that both purpose and destiny come from God and God alone. And see, purpose and destiny, sometimes people try to intertwine them like this. They're not intertwined. They run parallel side by side. Because purpose has to be fulfilled in order for you to get to destiny. So they can't be like this. They don't go, see, you don't have destiny while you're fulfilling purpose. You don't have destiny while you're fulfilling purpose. That's why they don't intertwine like this. They run parallel. So they one has this destiny sits and wait on you while you doing purpose. But purpose is the gift. The purpose is designed to do its function. That's what it does. It's a functional action. Whereas destiny is where your purpose takes you. The purpose or reason for which a car or airplane exists is transportation. It takes you from point A to point B. That is its purpose. But when you get to where you're going, it's its destination. To fulfill destiny is to take your purpose, which is the gift from God, and instructed or in where God has instructed and intended for it to go. Not where you want to go with it. Okay? Let me read that again. To fulfill destiny is to take your purpose, which is your gift, where God instructed or intended for it to go. Okay? So you can take your gift and go do something else with it. That's entitlement. You won't get to destiny, not God's destiny. You're just going to live in entitlement. And that's why we have a lot of people that's walking in entitlement and has taken their gift. But have you ever noticed they never get enough? See, entitlement makes you greedy. Entitlement makes you always striving for something. You're selfish. You never give anything. You're just a self-person, a person that's feeding you. That's what entitlement does. But see, in endowment, you will take your gift and you will share your gift. The world and the church are full of examples of using the purpose of something God has given us to do everything but God intended. See, we'll take our gifts and do what we think we're supposed to do with them. The greatest example of entitlement and endowment is Jesus. Now look, understand one thing. He was always God. He was always God. He never gave up being God. So he could have done a whole lot of things that he didn't do. And that's what is explained in the scriptures that we heard today. God didn't cling to his prerogative as God. In other words, he didn't cling to the things of God, which was a total entitlement. He didn't cling to that. He released that. Now he walked water. He healed the sick. He calmed the seas. He was a great teacher. He turned water to wine. He fed the multitude. But he gave all that up when he emptied himself. This is the good part right here. When he emptied himself, he gave up who he was, took on the form of a servant, a bond servant, gave up his authority. A bond servant is a servant that will serve you anyhow. Even if you say, I'm setting you free. You owe me, but I'm setting you free. I'm gonna let you go. You can go if you want to, but you say, you know what? I love what I do for you. I know that it's something in it for me. I'm not serving you because you own me. I'm serving you because that's my gift. I'm serving you to get where my destiny is taking me. I got to get to my destiny. So he gave up his authority. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways. So that lets you know he is who he is. He is the King of heaven, but is now in the form of a human, fully divine, but not clinging to it. He still was who he was, but he didn't cling to who he was. He became fully human. John 17:4, read that. I glorify you. He glorified God on the earth, having accomplished the work which you have given me. In other words, I have done what I was sent here to do. That's why he could empty himself. That was part of what he was sent to do. He said, what you have given me, I have fulfilled my purpose. Humbled himself even to death on a cross. He serves us by obeying death. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give himself as ransom. He paid the price, y'all. We were up in bondage, and it was a price on my head and your head. But God sent his Son, Jesus, to pay the price. Jesus came to serve through death. His death means something. See, we shouldn't take his death lightly. It accomplished something for me and for you. For all of us, he willingly didn't fight, didn't put up no struggle. He willingly chose to leave behind his status as an immortal, almighty God. My Lord, to leave it behind. How many of us will leave our power or who we are behind and put death on to buy us back from death? Y'all ain't hearing me, because this is shouting stuff right here. He died that we, all of us, might benefit. He died that we might live. That's why we can live. That's why we can do what we do today, because he died. It is public shame. The cross is the ultimate of humility. It is public shame on top of physical torture. How many of us could stand where God stood? You got no lower to go on the cross. You can't go no lower. He was gone from the highest of heights. He was all the way up and to the lowest of lows. Paul says in the text we read today, therefore. When you hear therefore, Paul normally means pay attention. Here's what all that means. Because he obeys, God exalted him. Because of his humility and obedience, God lifts Jesus from the lowest of lowest, like he can do with you, and exalts him. Because of this, God highly exalted him and gave him a name above every name, which every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that he is. He is Jesus. And it is because he humbled himself by dying and being raised again. Jesus Christ is Lord because he obeyed and God exalted him and placed everything, not something, everything under his feet. In other words, he went down with some power. He went down with some miracles being done. He went down doing some things for God. But when he got up with all power. Not some, but all power. He is now the bread of life. He is the resurrection. He is the rose of Sharon. He is the great I am. He is a will in the middle of a will. He is a doctor in the sick room. He is a lawyer in the courtroom. He is what he is. Whatever you need him to be. All I can say is he just is. Which is the ultimate endowment. What would Jesus, if he would not have received such an endowment, if he had not given up his entitlement? See, he had to give up something in order to get something. In that case, and he was rightfully due what he was entitled to. It was his. Peter said, the one whom you crucified. You make it personal. Make it personal. When you, the one you crucified, was made both Lord and Christ. The doors of the church are open. My Lord.
So if you are ready for your transformation, say this prayer with me. I confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in my heart he rose from the dead. Now by faith and according to your word, I receive the gift of salvation, the forgiveness of sin, and everlasting life. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. My friend, you now have new life in Jesus Christ. Welcome to the family.